I'll talk a little bit about it, and I'll do some demonstrations as we go. But wow, I love the creativity, and I love the fact that it's. I like the idea. It's about imagination, and
it
that's what I think is so cool about it. Yeah. Sorry, I'm a little mind blown. Does anybody need to like water on the face or anything after that?
Like,
cigarette. No, that was really cool. Thank you so much. So, I'm Dirk Stromberg. I'm a musician of a variety of kinds. One thing I'm into is designing instruments. So today, particularly, what I'm going to do is I'm going to look at, which I just realized I need something more. This instrument that I've designed and been working with. Which is kind of a culmination of some work, but particularly I'm going to be looking at the synthesis, so I'm going to have to break it open. So, to get it working. So, one of the big things I'm interested in are things like, basically, as an instrumentalist, I love this idea of what is an instrument. So, this is actually very much an instrument, which you'll see later. Some of you have seen this before, and so on. Okay. So a good number. So I'm not going to go into too much of a demonstration of that. You can play it later if you want. I'll put in orders if you prefer. Okay. So essentially, though, it's an aluminum pipe that I've beautified a little bit. I need to get my Texas out a little bit. On one side, we have an Arduino Mega, which is essentially capturing all my sensor data. And on the other side, we have a Raspberry Pi. And it's essentially designed to come apart, one for maintenance, two for software maintenance as I do upgrades and so on. So I think I've done a couple upgrades since in the last couple of weeks. Just it's an ongoing process in some ways.
Are you still picking hardware?
Well, I'm going to do a second version with the hardware. So there's there's some things I just kind of want to start over with. If that makes sense. So there's going to be an electronic wind controller on it. So have wind control, breath control. So that's going to be kind of that's the upgrade. So simple enough, Raspberry Pi 2, the 3 just came out today, Monday. So
nobody has it in their hands today, apparently.
Apparently, and I heard there's some available even, so.
Yeah.
Just, I'm not that I'm advertising or anything, but.
Do you have any chance? Yeah.
Ooh. It can be. It can be delivered by the government.
It could be available in this physical space,
this very room.
Yeah. So, anyway, Raspberry Pi 2, very simply, and we're just gonna plug it in to the HDMI input, which is right here, and we'll need audio out. It's a lot prettier when you don't take it apart, actually, but. It is. It seems kind of gets a lot more cumbersome with a lot more. Well, yeah. I didn't do that. In fact, when I first got it done, there was a question of okay, so now I have to take this back apart to get it going. So, fortunately, it wasn't too difficult, and we should boot up. Okay. So, what I want to do is talk about the synthesis. I got very much into kind of growing my own. Work a while ago when I was I'm a musician so in comparison to some code I've seen today which I have no idea it probably is all just gibberish anyway. In fact, that's the whole point of I can't even say the word
executable gibberish.
So here we go. So this is essentially this is it just booting up, and it'll boot right into my software. There we are. I will have to kind of face backwards because I don't have a screen. And so this uses a data flow graphical object-oriented graphical programming language called Pure Data. Okay, it was designed by a guy named Miller Puckett, who his first big project was designing a program called MaxMSP, which is a very popular program as well. MaxMSP was commercialized. There were some issues that he had with the original people, and he went out and did an open source version. It's one thing I'll say I love about Pure Data is I believe I have it on my cell phone. So it'll run on your cell phone. It'll run on Linux. It'll run on Windows. I don't know why you'd want to run it on Windows, but it'll run on OS X or anything else. So it's a pretty interesting language in that sense. It does work, as you can see, we have a number of objects and so on. So this, some of these objects here are objects that I've essentially made myself. So you can kind of make your own objects or at least make your own abstractions. You can actually make your own objects, abstractions or anything like this. And then of course you have very simple objects, like delay, which is very simple. This delays something to happen for a second. And this is a connecting port through my audio server. Linux is great. Any Arden Linux users in here? A couple? Good. So Linux, one of the early things that it did in 2002 was when Jack Audio Connection the kit came out, which is a fantastic tool for audio. Won a great award in 2004, and it's really funny because it is a high quality audio over network solution, and it always worked over network from the beginning. Dante, which is the commercial counterpart to it, came out 4 years ago, 5 years, 6 years ago. I mean, just to say, you know, Linux had something really amazing quite a while ago. So this boots up from here. I'm assuming everything's on and everything works. Okay, so it works. That's good to know. Okay, so what is it though? Which is probably a lot more interesting than knowing about this this awesome programming language, which you can check out on your own. Essentially, it's a few synthesizers that have basically been put together in a hybrid way. So everything you see here, this is HID. There's an HID input. That's because I've used the synth for other things, and so it has an easy hack into for HID that I'm using. I'm sure some programmer would sit there and say, you left all of your old code in there. Yes, I left all my old code just sitting in there as trash. Okay, so it's there as trash and has not been edited out. I did recently get rid of, there's also an analog control, so you can control analog synthesizers out of this. I have recently thrown that away, so that should make someone happy that my pack ratting is only partial.
Why the VNC server?
What?
Why the VNC server?
Oh yeah. Okay. So this was something I was working on at one point. It's, you can see it's actually disconnected. So you can, one thing that's great about PD, you can run shell scripts. Okay. So one thing is, and of course shell scripts, and you can actually see a couple up there. So of course, if you're a Linux user and you're not the greatest programmer in the world, running a shell script actually can get you a long way, because you can start to do things bigger than yourself. You know, it's. And so what I was doing was I was looking at ways of working on this on the road, very simply. And the idea was to run it on a VNC server. So just running a virtual network connection onto a laptop so I could run it in parallel. Not great, because I was getting some network, I was getting some issues between the Arduino and the network was not behaving nicely together. So, and I didn't spend a lot of time trying to figure it out, to be fair. I'm sure it's easy to fix for you people. Okay, so here you can see here actually original mapping. So here you can see the breath control actually was an original idea which has not survived, and it's coming soon to a theater near you. I'm looking at lip position, lip pressure. So there's actually, I was looking actually at touch pads. So some things have lived, some things haven't. Again, code that has survived. I'm not used to using this one. Okay, so if I open this up, again, I just get another object. Now, if you're a musician or worked in analog synths, this would make sense why a musician would do something so silly. Okay? It essentially works, the programming language works, it's top-down, so it works well in Singapore, and then right to left. I'm just kidding, I'm joking, sorry, you can throw something at me at any point. So essentially, it works. I guess JavaScript also apparently works right to left. We found out today, and so everything has to be kind of be ordered in a certain way. You can actually, and I've had worked on larger programs, which are much like psychoacoustics programs and so on. There, you actually have to start dealing with a little bit of your timing of processes a bit, so you don't start to, so not everything starts processing and arriving at the same time.
So are the lines sequential relationships, or are they more like a page pattern?
They are, well, patch panels would be sequential, right?
Well, you're moving
sequentially. Yeah, so you go from one place to another.
What's
So we'll get to the physical model in a second. Yeah, that's great. So, what it started off, so if we look at this, essentially, we have a number of synthesizers. So it's a hybrid synthesis technique, okay, that we're using. At the core of it, I designed a large physical modeling engine at one point, and it was just really fat. I mean, it just was never going to run on this poor little guy. And this is a very inefficient programming language, to be fair. And so I was reading an article on tri-stimulus synthesis. So the idea is using like the idea of RGB for doing additive synthesis, and looking at significant partials. And what I love about, of course, what's great about this is you start dealing with this idea that you can represent a huge number of sonic colors, timbres, in two dimensions. Right? I mean, if you translate it. So what we have, so if I look at it, I think this was obviously my second attempt at it. That worked better. Okay. So here we have, here it is. And so what I'm doing here is I'm creating, as you can see at the bottom, blue,
yeah,
green, and red. And I'm accepting X and Y, essentially. And so let me just clean everything up. So if I go, oh, sorry. So. I can start to kind of do different color things. It's not so easy to hear on here, actually. So what I'm doing though, is, as you can see, is I'm actually I'm not getting any. That's the center. So you can start to do things. So you're getting quite a bit of timbral control out of just one process. Yeah, so this is one joystick that's just controlling that. So this was kind of this is a nice find in the end, because it gives me a lot of control over. So I can do something like that. I'll try not to engage another part of the instrument. Or I can get something much brighter. And you can hear me, you can hear the harmonics changing in there for those who are. So this was quite useful to me because all of a sudden, you know, I get this, my first part of the synthesis is taken care of very quickly. So this is my, I use this now as my excitation source.
So, can't separate them easily. Your input, as you say, is the X and Y from one of the joysticks.
Yeah.
And what's coming out is three audible
representations of RGB.
But synthesized sounds.
What comes out of this are numbers.
Okay.
So.
Yeah.
So these all what comes out of here are numbers, and here you can see some at least some of the. Yeah, you can see the numbers right there. And you can see that I can, when I'm in the right position, you can see them changing. There you go. So then what they do is I'm just sending them, I send them now into three sets of oscillator banks. Okay, so it's a very small additive synthesis. synthesizer. It's quite, really quite light, which I like. So here it is. Again, things that are no longer connected, really. Always good to see. So here, obviously your fundamental, you want individual control over. Okay, so my first set of oscillator banks is not much of a bank. It's more of a withdrawal. And it's just this what singular oscillator sitting there, which I'm then controlling the amplitude of it. And then I have two other banks. And I essentially work in significant partials. So here, the next three partials are important. That makes sense.
What's a significant partial?
What is a partial? Okay, so if you look at a harmonic sound, so that would be a pitch sound. So for example, if I go, ah, you can sing back. And if I say, ah, can you sing back ooh on the same pitch? Ah. Okay, great. Cool. So that's a harmonic sound, right? If I ask you to sing back shh on ah, you're going to say shit, right? Okay, so a harmonic sound is a sound which can be sung, that is pitched, okay? And a harmonic sound will then follow the harmonic series. And a partial is then one part of that harmonic series. Okay. So here we have three oscillators that work together. Then, and so it turns out, and actually I read an article, I did a lot of testing, and actually this actually works pretty well. You can act that when you tie these three partials amplitudes together. Surprisingly. They work very well dependently on each other, and you can and it doesn't, it's not so offensive to the ear. So it does actually, it's amazing that they actually work quite nicely together. So I thought that was quite a nice find. And I don't think, it's the next set that I decided they needed a little bit more love. And they have one last set. Five and up, as it's called. So this night goes all the way to 11th harmonic. Most people say you need to 24, but I have other ways of getting the harmonics out. So this is just, because this is just my excitation source, I was okay with this in the end. Up to, depends, probably for men in our age, probably, 18,000 if you're lucky, hertz.
Yes, yeah, so you're not going to get the harmonics anyway.
You kind of lower frequencies.
Nine,
and so
9 hertz to
18,000. 20, yeah, 20. So you wouldn't be able to hear the higher frequencies. The other thing you have to worry about are things like Nyquist frequency and so on, right? If you know about sampling rates, Nyquist frequencies probably. Where essentially if you go over your sampling rate, the frequencies then fold back on themselves. And actually this will go over the Nyquist, and I can show you an example of Nyquist. So that... So there's actually a number of ways that you can hear it. But one way you can do it is when I move up an octave, you can hear some frequencies go down, some frequencies go up. So I go above the Nyquist. And so by going above the Nyquist, you have that. So then here, one thing I did here is I realized that not all 11 of these will go up nicely together. So actually I did a little bit of tweaking on my own end. As you can see, I've multiplied them to essentially make them, as they go up, they kind of taper off, and that kind of takes off some harshness that I didn't like about it. So there's a little bit of musical manipulation from the scientific paper, because I thought it was, yeah, I thought it was good. I liked the paper. I just had problems with it. I have it in my laptop, but I don't have a laptop with me. As you know. Frustratingly. So then I have a small physical model. This is actually a bit of my original physical model from another project that I worked on. And this is actually just one little part of it. Just to take a quick look at what the difference is. One thing is any audio signals are on these kind of thicker blue lines that you might see, and control signals are on the thinner black lines. So you can see, perhaps, this is thicker, this is thinner. Okay, and tilde, if you see tilde, that's an object that's dealing with signal processing. So you can have, it separates control and signal processing. You have to realize this paradigm, I mean, it comes out of a paradigm that was started, well, this idea of control signal and audio signal comes from analog synthesizers and then was repropagated in Music 1, Music 5 programming languages, C Sound from MIT, eventually MaxMSP, and then of course this. So it's lived, and even Super Collider and these more modern programs still have this part. So what this essentially what this is a comb filter, and it's running a comb filter, and in actually also running into the comb filter. Apparently, I like this. I'm using a phaser, so a sawtooth wave. And so what I was doing, I was reading a bunch of articles on physical modeling and looking at how you create different articulation types and looking at how you can use, so if you look at this, I use noise and I use a sawtooth wave mixed together, big noise. And what it is trying to create something much a complex input into the system. And so what it does is the noise emulates something like the breath, or this, the phaser represents something a lot more like a bow on a string. Because actually a bow on a string is actually very much like a sawtooth wave. Because when you hear a string being bowed, of course, you're hearing the string, but actually you're also hearing the sound of the bow of that string. So that's where that came from. And so this is kind of this really hybrid physical modeling idea that I got. Because again, I don't necessarily need it to sound like a clarinet or a flute or a violin. That's not my interest. But I wanted to behave a little bit like one, if that makes sense. You know, for me, it's not so much about like, it doesn't need to, like, hey, if I want a flute, I know people who can play the flute really well. Why would I waste my life trying to build that? But I started looking at the models, the physical models of how you can then essentially use those ideas to create more interesting, or no, that's not a fair, a different approach. It's not more interesting by any means. And the original physical model I had also had a different excitation source, which is in its own way nice, and was a bit more versatile, so it could actually sound a little bit more like wind instruments and brass instruments and string instruments. And it went then through several series of resonant filters, which I did as a physical modeling experiment. But it's very heavy, because you start using, if you're starting to look at, you know, it was hundreds of filters, you're very quickly bogging down your system. And also the control of hundreds of filters. In the end, a lot of music ends up being, you know, it's a little bit, I would imagine, like being a pilot. If anybody here a pilot? Great, so I can talk like I am. Okay, I'm not. But you know, you look at this, you know, one thing they were saying, you know, when they're building jets back in the 80s was this idea of how much can a pilot deal with? How much information before you have information overload. So how many, you know, if you could, you know, have 1,000 oscillators in front of you, that's great. But then how do you interface with it? How do you control all that? How do you put, you know, how do you tame it? And that's what probably a lot of us do in our technology lives anyway. Is how do we rein all of this in so we can then interact with it? And so things like this tri-stimulus synthesis is one way to work with it. This physical modeling technique, which you only see a little bit of here, is one way I dealt with that. So it's how can I sit there and take, you know, how do we simplify this information and yet get still the most diverse responses from it, right? We want a very dynamic response. We want, you know, if an instrument can only play one note in one way, that's incredibly interesting for a little while. You know, it's a great, you know, it's very neat, but really, like, that's all it's going to be. On the other hand, if it's totally uncontrollable and unstable and you can never get to any of the right places, like me on a trombone, it's totally useless. If trombone players, anybody here? Okay, good.
So you're right onto the table.
Right. Oh, grain 7.
Yeah.
Ah, this was my work over the weekend. Oh, great. I don't know why I called it grain 7, but I just knew that I had not used that yet, that table. So what this is, that's the next stage. Perfect. Your timing's perfect. Thank you. So what I did was I was working with some granular synthesis. I'm a huge fan of granular synthesis, where you take so granular synthesis is where you take sound and you chop it into little bits, to put it nicely. Particularly, I love what's called time threshing, which is a specific approach to granular synthesis where you take inputs and then you essentially reorder and cut apart those sounds into little sounds. Okay, it's a real-time process of taking audio inputs. It's called time. In this case, we're actually in this case, which is a very simple granular synthesizer. It's actually taking the input here, and it's actually there's slices that can go down to. I believe the textbook range is between 1 millisecond, because it's very hard to deal with anything smaller, up until 50 milliseconds.
Specifically, time slices.
Yeah, time slices. But it's also dealing. A lot of granular synthesis techniques also deal with issues of pitch. Within that and so on. So this one, the granular synthesis techniques here, I don't believe work with pitch. I have another one that does, but this one here is a very simple one, and it's just singular, and you also have synchronous and asynchronous. So is it rhythmic or not rhythmic? Okay, so, and it's quite nice, and I, in my other physical modeling technique, I do use granular synthesis to create that sense of instability that instruments have. It's a very nice way to do it, particularly when you start also then working with resonant bodies. So the idea is to take grains and use grains to then propagate like you would propagate sound waves. So it's a little bit like this idea. The idea came, of course, from looking at, is light a wave or a particle? And that's where the idea came from back in the... I'll do it right here. I'll do it now. So... So this is not the most exciting granular synthesis I have. Okay, what I do like this for was I play with a saxophonist occasionally, Tim O'Dwyer, and I love some of his sounds, and so I just wanted to be able to steal it. So if, you know, I can get some... So that's, it's a very simple granular synthesizer. That's essentially running some sort of, and I think it's actually just running, I can show you the shape. So the shape of, in granular synthesis, the speed of the grains, the density of the grains, the pitch distribution of the grains, the shape of each grain, so on. I think I have a granular synthesis technique which I think has 30 some inputs to control. So it itself is a, so this is a very simple table. Which essentially, this is the shape of my grain. Wrong button. Okay, so that's the envelope of each grain, is that. And this grain, you can't change the envelope on. You can hear it's just changing the speed of it. Okay, so now all of a sudden you can see that we have this now. And then we can start to do. So it's starting to get a little bit more complex. Now, next thing we have is working with amplitude modulation. So what I said this last time I presented here, so I didn't go into it, but I have a small fetishism for saxophone players. Well, not players, actually, but the instrument itself. It's a whole other thing with the players. that's a whole other evening. Well, that's later. Okay, but the saxophone is, and so a lot of what I look at is, well, how do they work? So one thing I realized, that actually a lot of what you see from saxophonists, we're dealing with essentially the way that they manipulate their breath through their embouchure is actually creating other vibrations. So that are very akin to amplitude modulation and frequency modulation. Right? Because essentially you are exciting and getting other harmonics out of it through these vibrations. So there is one of the first things I did added in was it was just amplitude modulation. It's falling apart. So, and actually that I'm using it in such a way to get the way to get it kind of the sub octave, which can be quite nice. And then one thing I said, well, that's nice. It's a good start to something. You know what I mean? I have that and I get that. And then it's also very physical. So when I play that, you know what I'm doing. It's not like, oh, what's he doing there? It's like, oh, okay. He's, you know what I mean? Something's happening. So then the next thing I have is, I said, well, frequency modulation is going to be even more wild, you know? So then, of course, it was like, and so I used asynchronous frequency modulation, amplitude modulation, which means that unlike if you look at synchronous frequency modulation, that means we all know what frequency modulation is. Okay. Well, we'll say we do. Anyway, if you do it, with synchronous frequency modulation, every pitch sounds exactly the same, which is essentially what you want in a synthesizer, allegedly. And for me, though, I'm using, although I'm not a saxophone player, but I'd like to think I am, I'm thinking like saxophone player, I don't need these harmonics to always sound the same. I want to have very similar control. I want to be able to control them, that's for sure. But I don't need it to be, I don't need uniform sound through the range. So that's why I can get, and you hear that I'm getting, as I'm glissandoing up, I'm getting very different harmonics. And that actually starts to sound, if you listen to any avant-garde saxophone players, actually, I'm starting to get close. And that's good. And then, so this was a lot of fun. So again, what I'm using is this tri-stimulus technique. There's some frequency modulation, some amplitude modulation to start to get a much more complex sound. We're starting to get somewhere. The last function you're going to see here is essentially just distortion. And it's by pressure. So the more I drive it, I just get distortion. It's just gain, essentially. And so I can drive. So actually, it's just all it does is it folds the frequency back. It's the function 10H. Okay, so it's just taking the signal and mapping it through that. So one, it's great. You know I won't clip, right? Because everything is hard limited through that. It's also not a hard limiting. So it's nice. So instead I just get artifacts. It's very musical. You know, the reason why guitarists love distortion, to give color, to build a relationship between color and dynamics. Because otherwise guitars have very little color range. And particularly in relationship to dynamics. So the idea behind this is, okay, I just want that, you know, I want to be able to sit there and say, okay, when I'm playing louder, I want it to sound like it's louder. You know what I mean? I don't want it just to be like, okay, he's playing, he's doing something up there. Which is probably still the reaction to some extent, but I'm okay with that part. So then that's the idea. And so if you look at what I'm controlling, in the end, my grandness and sis, I'm just controlling here, which is not my favorite control in the world, but that's why I put it right there, because I don't need it for a whole lot. If you look at my tri-stimulus, it's just one joystick here. Frequency modulation. And then pitch, answering your question now. So there's a pressure sensor here. Strip sensor that accepts all this information. It can be fretted or unfretted depending on how lazy you're feeling. So if you want to go chromatic, you can. Or if you're feeling more adventuresome, you can go unfretted. So, other than that, control, it's pressure sensitive as well. So using Velostat.
So you're saying you have multiple synths? Because it's sending out to.
I'll get to the next part. See, he's always, you're just like right on everywhere tonight. Thank you. So, and that's exactly it. So what, this is the first part. Okay. And this is essentially my source now, which I use a lot. There is one thing I did develop, a while ago, was another granular synthesis technique. This is is derivative of some of the work I did. But it was all about, it was the opposite idea. My first granular synthesis technique I did was just, there was something I wanted to do, and it was just, it's a really great technique, except for it's really piggy. It's really big. This was the, okay, so now how do I make this so it really, like, is digestible by this poor little bugger? Okay. Who's, you know, we're waiting for the Raspberry Pi 3 is much faster, I'm hoping. So what this is another granular synthesis technique. What I can do is I can fade between them. So, and you can see that's a much more interesting granular synthesizer. And what I can do with this granular synthesis technique, one thing that's I find quite interesting, I can change the envelope. So there you can see me changing the envelope. So if you want to... So again, I'm taking a joystick. I fell in love with joysticks at some point. This is an ongoing... It's kind of joysticks and saxophones, I tell you. And you can see I can now reshape that envelope to get very different sounds. And you can see that's actually quite complex. You can see actually that's... So I'm now actually modulating the grain. Cool. And so that's the shape of each grain. I got into this. This is actually from my original granular synthesis technique that comes from. Then what I realized is I just said, okay, we'll just do... We have sets of grains now. And this is it. So it's just... Oh, this isn't that one. Okay. See, I'd learn something new every day. And so this is a grain right here. This is this is an old process I came up with for a grain. So it's essentially, you have an audio input. Just to simplify this, you have an audio input here. And then all of this is processing to the length of the grain, making sure that the length of the grain fits it within the speed of the grain. And then if it's too long, it will at least wait. So it's, you know, all these kinds. It has latching functions in it and everything like that to ensure that all of the timing works out well. That's why you can see. And you can see this is asynchronous. That's why it continues to generate numbers. That's because it's random. So it's randomly generating numbers. You can see random up there, actually. And you can see that essentially you can change on on the grain, you can change the length of the grain, the offset. So that means how much off of zero. Zero would be the onset time, so how much you can offset from onset, which is, I believe, randomly controlled in this version. There's a grain ready, which is not being implemented here. There's a lot of things that have been cleaned up in here, it looks like. And then you're essentially, that is now running my envelope generator, which is essentially an oscillator. And then with that oscillator, which is timed to bang, it's timed to start and stop. It then controls my audio input. The audio input, it's exactly what you heard earlier, which you can hear it coming through. Is chopping it up. Yeah. So it's essentially just taking my original input and chopping it up. And so very very simply, I take this four grains. I didn't realize that. I didn't realize this is the version I was using here. Four grains, chops it up. And then sends it out to an output, which is probably on my main page. Output. It's a good name for it. Which this is very simple. This just does things, you know. I have a mono stereo version of it, so I have a switch to go from mono to stereo. Mono is particularly useful when you're using it with guitar pedals. So what I'll do is I hack together a pedal which can be volume or pan, and so I can then pan between guitar pedals or straight sound or something. So that was something I added since I was last here. Volume, you know, these things like volume become such an important thing with electronic music, of really being able to control that. And this kind of, sometimes it's the simplest things that go, man, I really just need it to do this. You know, I just need it to be quieter. You know what I mean?
You mentioned, I was going to ask you about pedals.
Yeah.
Are you still inclined to use pedals, or is it tempting to build filters and modules in this framework to perform the same functions? You've got enough controls in your hands to do it, or?
Yeah, I do use it with pedals. I mean, I do. The reason why I use it with pedals, there are some pedals out there that do really nice, very specific things. And they're really well designed to do one thing and one thing well. So for example, I have a Grander Synthesis pedal, which I really like. I'm seeing a small trend here, with foot control. So you can, you know, all of a sudden, it has a very specific color. And to actually program that would be possible. But is it worth my time at a point? Isn't that the question? I also have a really nice analog ring modulator. You know what I mean? You go, oh, it's a nice ring modulator. You know, it is its own thing. I have a decent... For some of the analog gear...
That's actually quite expensive. Go on. It's not a kit with a cycle or something.
What? Ring modulation?
Ring modulation?
Yes.
That's expensive.
Not anymore. I mean, fortunately, I mean, electronics have come down in price. Definitely. So they're not necessarily cheap. But yeah, pedals, I mean, you know, so I use them because they can do certain things. I feel that they extend what it is. You know, I don't think they're an integral part of what it is, but they can extend it. So when I start looking at doing shows that are an hour and a half long, I'm very happy to have a little something extra. And so is probably the audience at that point. So in the end, yeah, it's actually limited controls is a big part of it. And the idea is just very portable, very small, very easy to set up, boots right up. So a lot of it just comes down to very practical things. Because the instruments are very practical. You know, you take them out of the case and they've got to work. You don't want to see a horn player. You don't see acoustic musicians get out and say, "I'm sorry, it's not working today."
hang on while I reboot my saxophone.
Yeah, and I actually had this. I was playing a gig and someone unplugged my power master, and it was fine. You know, it was just that moment. You go, you plug it back in. You wait a minute. You're ready to go. It's not. You know, there's no like, oh my gosh, is it going to work? And what's going to happen next? You know, and there's that kind of robustness that I was very interested in. You know, within the synthesis context. So it gives me a huge variety of colors, and it's quite controllable for what I need. So, great. Questions? More? I have nowhere else to lead there. You've been following my line perfectly. I'm glad we prepared this.
Do you have any problem with latency? Let's say if you want to do like scale runs, I noticed that it's like usually like slow music. If you want to do that scale, how's the response?
Oh well, that's not easy music. So it's yeah, latency is about I think it's 5-6 milliseconds. It's more than I would like, but these guys, you know, part of it's just this is the Cirrus Logic chip on here, Raspberry Pi. I love you guys, but it's much better. It's a much nicer clock than what's in the Raspberry Pi, but even that clock, it's hard to run much faster than that.
Did you have to put anything to make it more sensitive, or
the which what part?
In your
I don't use the built-in audio, so I use a external sound card.
Is it the Wolfson audio?
This one is, well, Wolfson got bought by Cirrus Logic, so yeah. On the I use the Wolfson on the old ones, and then the new ones I use the Cirrus Logic, and I'm really quite happy with it. By the way,
yeah.
I would be.
They would. Yeah, I mean,
there is the onboard stuff is bullshit, basically.
It is. It's terrible.
It's an 11-bit VAC, which is like, what are you even doing?
Yeah.
I don't even know where they came with this 11-bit number.
Yeah.
Oh, what's the name again?
This is Cirrus Logic. It's made of. Yeah, you can buy it off of Element 14.
Okay.
I don't know. Sorry, I don't know if Geek.
Official by
CIRRUS.
Yes.
Yes.
Those guys.
Those guys. Same guys.
Like disappeared.
No. Apparently, they just bought somebody too, which is, I couldn't believe.
They bought a company super famous for doing audio.
Yeah.
DACs.
Yeah.
Both sets, like
the DAC guys.
Yeah.
So it's actually a decent chip. It's relatively quiet. I've done some testing on this because I actually was developing a audio card based off of Raspberry Pi. So they're network based audio interfaces essentially. Although I didn't do that. I just did the networking and essentially just the shell commands for the jack to connect correctly. And it's really quite good actually. I've done some reasonably sized shows with them, and nobody's complained about humming, hiss, and this stuff. So they're quite quiet, and you can run them pretty quick. So I'm really actually happy with them. I could really advertise them. I really could go into advertising.
Is that being done by the Pi or by the Cirrus Logic chip?
Which part? The programming? All of the heavy load is on the Pi. The chip, the Cirrus Logic chip, is merely the converter. So it's doing the digital to analog conversion for the audio output. So that's its only job. So of course, if you get a chip to do just one thing, of course it's going to be better at it.
Yeah,
yeah.
So there are exceptions.
But you'd hope. I mean,
your strip and pressure sensor, we did just place it together. How did you?
I can take this off. This Velcro here, actually, I use it to adjust my. It adjusts my. Action, so I can actually make my action more or less loose. So if I can take this off, actually. You want to see this too, Leon?
Yeah.
I think this is exactly what Leon wants to see from me today. So this just comes off. Yeah, it's just Velcro. Don't worry about it. Some people look at me like, no. It's okay. If it breaks, it's just again. That's all. So if you come up here, if you want to see it. So here, this essentially is. This is. I'm sure you know what this is. This is just
it's
pressure. Ribbon sensor, not pressure, but just ribbon sensor. Right off the, obviously right off the store, a little heat string extra. And this is the Velostat. And so it's just essentially one piece of Velostat, copper tape on both sides, enough electrical tape that the aluminum doesn't, because man, when that happens, ho-ho! Smells funny, and there's this smoking. It gets very hot.
Magic smoke gets
out. Yeah. I'm not that I've done it before, but I heard it burns. I heard. I had a friend. And so yeah, good amount of electrical tape. And then this is just these are just here to give me my pads. Yeah, because originally I was actually looking at just having this down, but actually it was really nice to be able to take it off of the. Velcro, because the Velcro just actually adds more resistance before you start pushing down on it,
right.
So it takes a lot more
right.
distance, so when you talk about facility and speed and everything, you lose a lot of that, so that's nice. So the Velostat's quite good. You the only thing about it, because it's pressure resistant fabric, it's like rubber. It's rubbery. You can actually feel a little bit of it here. The larger the piece, you will want to use different pull down resistors, if that makes sense, because you just need less resistance. So I had I did some tests to figure out, you know, this.
I guess after you cut, you have to calibrate the piece that you have.
Yeah. Well, once you cut, you calibrate the piece, and it's easy enough, and actually you get relatively good. I can probably look at it. I bet it's in here. You can tell how good my memory is. I actually only did this a couple months, 2 or 3 months ago, and I have no idea what I've done. Okay, so here it is. So this is it runs on Fermata. And so this is raw input right here, as it looks. It's pretty well organized, actually. I'm impressed. So you can see here, this is my This would probably be, oh, it's my neck pressure. Yeah. So that's my range. Oh, it's pretty relatively good. And then my fretboard. I have accelerometers inside, three accelerometers. You can see over here. So you can see that that's with that amplitude modulation. And then just joysticks, and then my switches. So it's a relatively, you know, electrically, engineering, the software and everything is a relatively simple process. I mean, it's a very, you know, but it's always about how do you make it musical and everything. And so that's where I really.
When does it have sysnets?
Yeah, I was going to ask the same question. Is there a MIDI? PD sysx.
Here. No idea. Should we take a look though? Let's learn together.
It's a thing that's connected somewhere. The sysx is an extension of the MIDI standard.
Yeah. What's your price? So interestingly enough, probably, and I know why, the Teensy, the Arduino Teensy will output MIDI.
Yes.
So that is probably why it's in here, and they probably designed this
with the
Teensy also in mind. Although this was meant for the Mega, I find that most of it is pretty interchangeable, so they want very interchangeable programming. That's probably why it's there. But that's a guess, so if you quote me on that, it's totally deniable. Unless it's right.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah, you get how it works. And this is just telling us what is connecting and how. So, yeah, this hasn't really been cleaned up a lot. One thing that's great is you can, this is obviously totally stolen out of the help file for Fermata on Pure Data. There's not a whole lot extra work done on it, just cleaned up. So there's a lot of PD users are famous for doing that. I think this is the only thing stolen out of the help file, but man, it was stolen. So yeah. Other questions? Oh.
More the hardware. There seemed to be an awful lot of wire.
Yeah, that's Leon had mentioned this is not the cleanest way to do this. Or safest.
Yeah, indeed.
And nice. Imagine tell Dirk the yellow wire came out, let's see what he does.
Do you know what I say?
Nice.
Okay, here we go. Again.
Nice aluminium case. What's
going
on?
Has anybody in this tried? How did he react?
I need to, I'm going to meet up with a violinist. I've been trying to meet up with a violinist.
I see.
To talk about that. It's all of this. All of that.
It's just a body of yellow wires.
Yes. It's a great idea, right?
Yes. He has a fetish with yellow as well.
It's artistic, huh? It's artistic. Yeah. I'm not an Along, I'm not an Abeng, I'm not an Alien, I'm an artist. No? Okay. That wasn't the worst reaction I've gotten from that. So. And then I just, run along. This one I like because it tells you how much is left.
Nice.
I'm very happy about that. Because there are times you're doing gigs, you go, so how long can I go? But these will last, they'll power high forever.
Really?
Cool. I have a 10,000 as my reserve, and it'll power for,
looks nice.
I think I did it 8, 10 hours.
Does that go into your...
No, actually it has to go outside,
okay.
Unfortunately. So it actually goes on right here.
Okay, so you also get to see how long you have.
Yeah, it's not all bad. Because you do want to know at a point. Not that they last so long, actually. I mean, these things run on nothing,
yeah.
as you all know. So, but feel free to lift it up, play it. If it comes apart, it's just good learning for me.
Okay. That's right.
That's my approach to this. I had to build a kernel, but I was a Linux guy for about 10 years now.
So 10 years ago,
you had to build a kernel to do anything.
Sure. You don't press that.
So yeah, that's all.
The hope is that is not the case
today. I still build my own kernel.
Uh-huh, okay.
If you want high function, if you want, you know, the functionality you need for audio, you're still building your own. Occasionally one will be released that's good.
Is Karma's low latency thing still a thing?
Karma's still around, yeah. I
no,
don't use...
Because you do this low latency kernel.
Yeah. It's still good. Okay. I'm not a Fedora user.
Maybe
okay.
Because
but otherwise, I was for a while. I tried it. Probably turned the volume down.
Okay.
The only thing
you
I know about that, yeah. I have no idea how
no,
this works as well.
Other way.
Oh.
Down is up.
Down is up. See? He remembers from the last class.
Yeah.
Down is up. Up is down.
Oh. Oops. Okay. Okay. Oh, interesting. Okay.
So, yeah, Karma is still doing theirs. There is a Ubuntu Studio, but they're not doing real-time
yeah.
kernels anymore.
Yeah.
this is obviously running on a...
Raspbian. Yeah.
So, I everything I do is Debian, so it's easy.
Do you take anything out? I mean, like, just standard Raspbian, or...?
It's a new kernel.
So, you basically take the kernel that is, you patch it with...
It's a... heavily patched and configured kernel. But yeah, it's a patch and configured. It's not really new. So you get the real-time patches. So that's easy to do. But other things that to get the CS logic working takes a little bit of patience.
That's what I was afraid of. A friend of a friend was asking me about real-time audio on the system. And I was like, yeah, Wolfson's making a stack, but
yeah,
I don't know how easy the driver support stuff it is.
Okay.
Why not just compile a kernel?
Very
soft.
Yeah.
So you do. Okay, good. I'll tell him that.
I'll give him a kernel.
Sure. I'll let him know. I'm not sure if he wants to do this combination or not.
For audio, the problem is the only other company that's making audio for embedded systems like this is Axiolos, something like this. It's a new system.
Axiolos?
Yeah. The new one, right? The board with that.
Yeah. There's a super new one called Bella, which was like on Kickstarter yesterday, or day before, from CMU.
Okay, no, the Axolotl has been out for a while.
Yeah.
They just
Axolotl has
theirs.
Been out for a year.
Because I was just I ran to the guy. The only reason why I ran to the guy when I was in Sweden, and he had this thing, and I was like, wow, what you do is cool.
Yeah.
Like, you make me feel like, I mean, this is so important. But I actually need to get one, because the programming language is very similar to this. Because he also designed his own programming language.
Yeah.
And it's built in, and it has a relatively high quality audio output, good processing power. So it's actually a really nice all-in-one system for embedded work.
And
Yeah.
So two or 3 days ago, there was a new thing from CMU.
Okay.
One of their HCI labs, whatever. It's a BeagleBone-based cart.
Nice.
And basically similar concept, and made for real-time audio. And
oh, great.
Kind of so
and running, and that will run Linux as well.
Yeah, that's a BeagleBone set of Linux, but you just need someone to sit down and make a card with a decent deck and, you know, get all this shit together.
That's
easier said than done.
Exactly. And that's why, that's kind of why I've stuck with this. And that, you know.
Makes sense.
Yeah. I don't know if it's the best solution, if that makes sense, but it's kind of the solution I know at this point.
The solution that works for you is the best thing. So
I think some folks have used that Behringer USB card.
Yeah. I've used, actually...
I guess size is an issue there, right? Or
size is an issue.
Yeah.
That's the other thing. But I've used this with, external audio cards, and actually faster.
Yeah,
for sure.
So, like,
you need the power then separately as well.
You don't have to. No, you can actually, I have run I've run a Native Instruments card off this, a complete chix.
Bring it,
so then you're actually getting like, wow, I get a preamp. It's not bad. Because it's, because they don't take a lot of power.
Yeah. Interesting.
I'm not sure if I was running out of battery, but even this, the battery would it's only
you could even move
for what's so much
accelerometer.
Yeah.
You
need to have more pressure.
It's not heavy.
But it needs more pressure.
Yeah. it Sea Shepherding? Sea Shepherding?
Oh, you need to set the volume at which you want.
You know, to the blue screen.
Or
your left thumb. You don't go down.
He makes it look so easy, it's not so easy.
No, no.
It's a lot pressure. Then. So amazing dexterity for it.
You should ask Cedric about this. So there's a guy in his hackerspace in Paris that plays around with this stuff.
This is my second instrument with it too. It's great stuff.
When I was living in Hackerspace, there was this guy that showed me what I was
doing. Wow. It's great stuff. So if you look at, just move over, you can play a bit. If you look at this, you can see it. You can see, if you look at neck pressure. Oops, sorry.
Oh, the neck is.
And then you can let go. So you can see it, you can actually get.
0.7 to 0.9.
It's warmed up now. So what I did is I had to build it with a margin because the longer you play it, it tends to the range moves up.
Oh.
So it has it's I worked out how to deal with that for now until I fix it, figure out why.
So that one's pressure and this one is just the position.
Yeah.
So it's actually this. So it's actually this thing that's pressing onto it. This rubber is the one that's actually pressing it.
Yeah. So it's just the pressure between.
It's between the rubber to here, right? It's actually the rubber that's caused that. It's actually the force.
But there's enough. The distribution's decent enough between that it works okay.
And you, so you actually have the copper tape, and then after that you solder onto the copper tape.
Yeah. So you can probably see. Well, yeah, you can see a bit of solder probably in there. It's very simple. But it's great because it's totally pressure sensitive. And it's really
you put one end, you put 5 volts, and the other side. Can you 5 or you put 3 volts?
It is 5.
That's the one. That's the one.
Oh, yeah, because you're going to the Arduino.
The one in front is just
Arduino has 3.3. Arduino has 3.3.
Oh, yeah, okay.
Yeah.
Thanks.
Oh, thank you.
It's just resistance.
It's because I tried it, there's not too much to how you press it. You can't really see much change in the
resistance.
But like what you say, apparently your cooldown resistor has an influence on it. Based on the size of the velocity.
And also copper. So, yeah, so because you have to put the copper tape on, so I'm sure that's also affecting your connection and everything, right? Because
it's
more
copper on one side and copper on the other side.
Yeah.
I think basically what I did was that I had the copper going one way and copper going the other way.
And you can actually, and this is something I spend a lot of time. You can actually run the copper off both the same side, both at the same end. Yep. I thought it had to be end to end, but you know you can do both off the same end. It works fine. I just picked my case in point. No, what happened was, I was working on this while my wife was home, and so anything I did, where like tape was showing, she would start, "Dirk, why are you being lazy?" Okay. You got the gatekeeper. You always have the gatekeeper. You understand this?